Thank you. Professor Corporon for inviting me to talk a little bit tonight, and it's a really great opportunity to hear these pieces a couple times and hear a little bit about them. My comments tonight are going to complement and supplement a little bit the notes in the program, which are actually quite good, and there are multiple excerpts from the Frank Zappa autobiography, the real Frank Zappa book. And I think when you read those program notes, it gives you a really good sense of just what kind of composer Zappa was, how he was had a passion for music and just sounds in general, and also gives you a little bit of his quirky sense of humor and ironic, kind of satirical approach to life and politics and society and all that. I think you get a little elements of that in the program note. So what I thought I'd do is, in these two presentations, both pieces tonight, they're a little bit different in their genesis, and they're also a little bit different in kind of the world they come from. So Zappa is an interesting composer because he has a kind of one foot in popular music, commercial music, rock music, and another foot in classical concert music, and both in a kind of experimental way. In this piece, I think you could probably hear it's a little bit more of the, I'd say maybe more the concert music kind of language and maybe a little more experimental. And I think that one of the things, if you know anything about Zappa's music, you might have recognized some things that are really distinctive, like the virtuosic percussion writing and the kind of circuitous melody lines and the use of color, which is a very common thing in all of Zappa's works. One thing I wanted to kind of set the context for this is just to give you a little bit of background on Zappa. He was a very precocious child and very curious. And one of the things he says in his autobiography is that he learned how to make gunpowder when he was 6 years old. I don't know if that's apocryphal, but he said he used to experiment all the time with chemicals. His dad used to work creating chemicals for military applications in the 1940s. So Zappa figured out ways of like taking gunpowder out of bullets and caps and shaving ping pong balls to get powder that he could make explode. He says he almost blew himself up once with these experiments. He took, because his dad worked in this with chemicals for the military, the whole family had a set of these gas masks in case there was some kind of leak in the house with chemicals. And he was so curious about what made the gas mask work that he took the thing apart, which basically rendered it useless for any kind of chemical accident that might have happened. But I think the idea that this idea of experimentation, just curiosity, how things work, like how do those chemicals interact with each other and how does that mask work? That's basically the idea he brought to his music. He was fascinated with just how sound works and how it comes together, and he just was endlessly interested in what kinds of combinations you could make with music. And this is one of the things in the program notes talks about the Edgar Varese album that he found, that he read an article on Sam Goody, the record promoter and record store owner. One of the things it doesn't say in the notes that's interesting is that, you know, Zappa had this idea that he loved science and he was kind of thought of, had a scientific mind. And when he went into this store and he saw this album, he didn't put two and two together that he had read this article about this Varese, who wrote this experimental music with a bunch of percussionists and noise. And Sam Goody said it was an awful album, but just noisy. And he goes into this record store and he sees this LP. You know, of course, in the 40s and 50s, most kids, they could afford an album, they would buy a 45, you know, just with a single on it. He saw this LP, which was for old people, bought those because they were very expensive, you know. And this LP was sitting there, and it had a picture of Varese. And Varese was a very stern-looking guy with a very serious face and kind of, you know, kind of angry, piercing eyes. And his hair was this wiry, gray hair that stood straight up. And Zappa saw that album, he says, "Whoa, this is great, a mad scientist made an album. Like, I didn't know a mad scientist could make music." And then he found out, it's like, "Oh, that's that album I was looking for." And so he wanted to buy this album, and the record store promoter said, "I just use it to test the equipment around here. It's horrible. So if you want to buy it, I'll give it to you for half price or whatever." So Zappa, as it says in the, as you read in the program notes, he played that album, drove his mother crazy. But I think it's one of the things that you hear on envelopes in the percussion is that Varese's music is highly percussion oriented. In fact, he was a pretty important innovator of percussion music in the 20th century. And so Zappa picked up on that and uses a lot of innovative techniques with percussion. But for this piece in particular, I think your ear might be drawn to the percussion lines and the color of the percussion and some of the rhythmic stuff that's going on. But it's, except for the percussion, it's rhythmically pretty straightforward in the wind parts, because what he's really experimenting with here is harmony. And the chords, as it says in the program notes, are mostly 7 and 8 note chords. Now, if you think about most tonal music. In our, first of all, we in our Western system, we have a scale of an octave that has 12 notes. And most scales that are like major and minor, the systems that we use in tonal music, they just use seven of those notes. So seven at a time. And if we make chords, we usually just use three of those notes, alternating notes. Like if you look on the piano, if you do every other white note, you're going to triad with three notes. And sometimes we'll use a seventh chord. And then jazz, you'll find a ninth chord, another note in there, and 11ths and 13ths. So they just keep adding these notes. But usually even in jazz chords that are more complex, they won't play all of those notes. They maybe only play five notes at the most, four or five notes, something like that. Zappa's using seven or eight notes in here. And so these chords are very dense, and they're very, it creates these very unusual harmonies, very dense textures. And he's, think of it, he's using two-thirds of the notes in the chromatic scale, right? So you've got these things moving along and moving in these different directions and everything. So it's one of the reasons why when you listen to the line, it has this very kind of circuitous, serpentine kind of feel to it. But then the harmonies above them are what the real experimentation is in there. So I think when you listen to it again, pay a little bit of attention to the harmonies that are going on in the wind parts, because that's where a lot of where Zappa's experimenting in this piece. And then when I come back after Dog Breath Variations, I'm getting ahead of myself on that, I will play a couple examples from the earlier work. The previous examples of envelopes were pretty much the same. He didn't do a lot of changes with that. But with Dog Breath Variations, there were a lot of changes that he made, so I'll talk about that on the next piece. So enjoy envelopes again. So I think you can probably tell this is a little more, maybe less abstract and a little more tuneful than the previous piece, but I think you can still hear some of the same harmonies, some of the same kind of serpentine melodies that are going on in there, but it definitely has a much more of a kind of accessibility to it than I think envelopes has. And I think this also demonstrates some of the other composers that Zappa was a fan of, that his discovery of Varese led him to look for other composers. He discovered Webern, Anton Webern, and Igor Stravinsky, and Bela Bartok, and he discovered some experimental jazz musicians like Charles Mingus and Anthony Braxton. So it kind of, his world just kept expanding like that. Simultaneously, when he was young, he had a band. He loved rhythm and blues, and he loved like Muddy Waters. Johnny Guitar Watson was one of his heroes, so he learned drums first, he played guitar, he had a band that played rock music that eventually became kind of the undercurrent of what he would do and what he'd be known for in his life, which is a band leader, rock band leader. But he really did that primarily so he could support his concert music. He really wanted to be an experimental composer like Varese, but he knew there was no money in it. And so he thought, well, if I have this rock band, and even though his rock music was pretty quirky and weird and experimental in its own route, in its own way, he was able to use this as a vehicle to support his other music. And so the genesis of this work, in fact, it's not one work, it's two, and I kind of gave it away in my last talk. This is actually both of these pieces that make up Dog Breath Variations. One is called one is Dog Breath, and the other one is Uncle Meat. And these both come from the album Uncle Meat, which Zappa produced in 1969. It was actually supposed to be a soundtrack to a film that he was working on. And the film didn't get produced for another 20 years or so. But he was also, in addition to being a composer, he was a filmmaker. He made a number of films and composed the music for it. He was actually an innovator in film. Film 200 Motels was like one of the first use of videotape instead of 16-millimeter film. So this is actually based on two works that are on the Uncle Meat album. The one of which is called, is a song actually, it's a vocal song called Dog Breath in the Year of the Plague. And the second one is called Uncle Meat, which is the title track from the Uncle Meat album. That's an instrumental piece. So what I want to do is I want to play two examples from the Uncle Meat album. And I'll tell you, to listen for in the lyrics here, one of the things to know about Zappa, he moved to California, he lived in all different places in the up in the high desert, and he lived out in the San Gabriel Valley, but he tended to associate with a lot of kind of marginalized communities. So like his first band that he was with had Latino and African-American band members, and he was kind of himself being of Sicilian descent and not really fitting in with the kind of, white folks in the town that he grew up in. He really associated a lot with the Chicano culture. And this piece, you'll actually hear some references to not just Chicano culture from Los Angeles, but also this kind of larger Pachuco culture, which was big in the 1940s. If you've ever seen the Zoot Suit from like the 40s, it's got a very brash kind of culture. And you'll hear references in this song, which is the Dog Breath in the Year of the Plague, to a lot of these kind of Chicano references to his 39 Chevy and he's primering a Chevy, and it's El Monte Legion Stadium, and it's got fuzzy dice on the mirror and the bongos in the back. These are all very much cultural references that Zappa felt very close to because so many of his friends were in that community. And so this is a little bit of an homage to that subculture in Los Angeles. And we'll listen to about 40 seconds, 50 seconds. This is track one. So this is Dog Breath in the Year of the Plague. So this is the source material for the first half of Dog Breath Variations. Dog Breath Variations. It's a pretty, I wouldn't say it's a standard pop song, but you can definitely hear pop elements to it. And even then, he's experimenting with it, right? He's doing weird things with the tape machine, speeding up the voices, and he's doing a lot of interesting things with the mix. He thought of the electronic studio, the recording studio, like a laboratory in a way. So that was kind of one of the things he was doing in this album. The second track I'll play is the Uncle Meek title track. And you'll also hear, this is an instrumental, it's not a vocal in there, but you'll also hear some unusual timbres. I mean, this is supposed to be ostensibly like a rock album or a popular music album. He's using like tuba and harpsichord and oboe, and he's using instruments that you would normally not hear in a popular music album. And he's also doing some quirky things with the timbres and with the registration of the instruments and just kind of an unusual setting here. So let's play this track too. This is the Uncle Meat title track, which is the second half of Dog Breath Variations. A lot of weird sounds, kind of quirky timbres and things, but you also hear a lot of the virtuosic lines, like in the percussion and the melodic lines and everything that you'll hear, that you've heard in the band, you're going to hear again. Now, just to kind of close this up, to tell you where this went from there. So this is 1969, Uncle Meat album. In 1971, as it says in the program, he did a transcription of this for his band, the band he had in the early 1970s, just another band from L.A. That was the album there, and it was a rock band version of that. And that was the first time he combined those two together. And he, actually, even in the album Uncle Meat, he has a Dog Breath Variations in there, and he also has an Uncle Meat Variations in the album. It's a double album, so it's very long. And he kind of concatenated all these things together, put these different tracks together, and created this kind of two-part form, Dog Breath Variations and Uncle Meat. That track then became the work that he would transcribe for the Netherlands Wind Ensemble, and eventually he did some other transcriptions, but the last one he did was with the Ensemble Moderne that he worked with on the Yellow Shark album in 1992, right before he died. So those are the two albums that are more symphonic versions of this, and I think it actually, to me, works very well as a symphonic piece, and the band version works really well. It's almost like those pieces were intended for this kind of an ensemble, even though he was writing for smaller forces at the time. So with that, hopefully you'll know what to listen for, and an appreciation for Dog Breath Variations. Times two.